Last time, we considered somewhat easy type of homotopic properties. Easier results, but they are all important, of course. So today we will do a little deeper into these aspects. So now we have to appeal to the coherent topology more clearly in defining the homotopies also inductively. So I would like to present a result which will be applicable to any space which has this coherent topology, and then we will use it for simplicial complexes. Namely, the topology on simplicial complexes is coherent with the skeletons, n skeletons, or it's coherent with each simplexes, closed simplexes, and so on. One can use that. So here is a general result of getting certain homotopies on coherent topologies. Start with the topological space with the topology coherent with the closed family, this increasing family X0 contains X1 plus X1. They are all closed subsets of X. Union of Xn is X. A set is closed inside X if and only if its intersection with each Xn is closed inside Xn. That is the meaning of the topology is coherent. Now take U to be any open subset of X. Put U and S intersection of U with Xn. Suppose each UN is a strong deformation retract of the UN plus 1, the next one, which is a subset of that. UN is a subset of UN plus 1. Then U naught, which is U intersection X naught, is a strong deformation retract of the entire U. So what we are seeing is similar to the previous part. If we just don't strong deformation, just take retract. So we had this kind of thing coming in the previous thing, retract. But now we want a strong deformation retract, means we are referring to the homotopy here. So start with a sequence of strong deformation retractions Fn from un cross I to un. Okay, it is identity of un when x when t is 0, or it is x is inside un minus 1. Okay. And the last thing, namely Fn of X1, is inside Un plus 1. So this is a strong deformation of Un into Un plus 1. Okay. So this is the hypothesis. Let us put Fn of X, this is just a short notation, to the Fn of X, 1. Okay. Which we know is homotopic to identity, keeping un minus 1 fixed. Okay, and ufn itself is a retraction from un to un minus 1. That's why it's a strong deformation retract. Let us put gn equal to f1 composite f2 composite fn. Fn brings un to un minus 1, then un minus 1 to un minus 2, and so on. Finally, f1 will bring the entire thing into u0. So Gn is a retraction of Un to U or not. Okay. Being a composite of retractions, it's a retraction. Okay. But each of them is strong different retraction. I can take the composites of these retractions. Okay, composites each time. So it should be a strong different retract to Un to U not. There's no problem. Moreover, Gn plus 1, which is Gn composite, one more Fn plus 1. Fn plus 1 is identity on un. So Gn plus 1 restricted to un is Gn. Only the first n of them will operate. Fn plus 1, composite Fn plus 1 part will be identity on un. So Gn plus 1 restricted to un is Gn for all n. Therefore, I can define gx as gn of x whenever x is inside un. So this g will be defined on the entire of u now. Okay, then g is from u and takes values inside u naught because each gn of x lands inside u naught. So continuity also follows because restricted to each xn means intersection with xn, it's just un. On that un, it is a continuous gn. So g is continuous, it's a retraction from u to u naught. The only problem here is that where is the homotopy? Okay, what is the meaning of concatenating infinitely many homotopies? See, when you take one homotopy here, another homotopy here, the composition of homotopies is not composition of functions, it is composition of, it is concatenating the homotopies. Okay, that is why this requires a better attention, more attention. It has to be done properly. Okay, how to show that it is a strong deformation tracks need a little more effort. So here is what we have to do. Okay. So start Gn from un cross I to un. Okay. Let us define this one inductively as follows. The first one, G1, is in the first half of the interval, it is x. The second half of the interval, it is f1. It is a composition. Composition means a concatenation, like a composition of two paths for each x. Okay, path composition. It is that. So first half, 0 to t less than good half, it's x identity map. And it is f1, which we know what it is, f1. Okay, f1. So this is just definition g1. G2 onwards, there will be slight difference. That's why I have to define it separately. Namely, by this formula, the n plus 1 of xt will be defined three different intervals here. The entire the interval 0, 1 is divided into three portions. The first portion is 0 to 1 divided by n plus 2. Second portion is n plus 2 to 1 divided by n plus 1. And all big chunk 1 by n plus 1 to 1 by up to 1. Okay. So in the last part, what it is, let us look at this one. It is gn of fn plus 1 xt, the biggest rectangle. Okay. Gn of fn of x plus t. When t equal to 1 by n plus 1, it should coincide with this one. Right? Because there are two definitions. Could n plus 1, what happens? When t equal to n plus 1, t equal to n plus 1 here, okay, n plus 2 divided by n plus 1 minus 1, that is just 1 by n plus 1, that n plus 1, n by n plus 1 cancels away. This is fn plus 1 of xt. Fn plus 1 of x1, actually. Okay. But Fn plus 1 of x1 is by definition Fn plus 1 x. Right? At that point, Gn of that, t equal to 1 by n plus 1, Gn of that is just identity. Therefore, Gn of Fn plus 1 is Fn plus 1 itself. Okay, so that's why these two coincide. Similarly, when you can check that when t equal to 1 by n plus 2, t equal to n plus 2, is n plus 2, n plus 1 by n plus 2 is 1 minus 1 is 0. Fn plus 1 of x 0 is by definition identity. So it is identity. So these things make sense and they patch up to define a continuous function. It is in this portion, small portion, its identity. Remember, as n keeps increasing, this will never hit, you know, there will be some interval, this will never hit the line 0 cross I. Okay, 0 cross I is always here and it will be x, its identity there. So this line, this one, this interval keeps coming closer and closer to 0. Okay, but for all n, it is still some interval will be there. So that is the nature of this. And each gn plus 1 makes sense. All right. So here is the graphical representation of g1 is half the time it's x, half the time it's f1. g2, this is half the line. From here to here, it is g1 of f2. Here it is f2. Here it is x. This is 1 by 2 and this is 1 by 3. The next time, again 3 divisions, but this line will be forgotten. Okay, of the entire thing here, from here onwards, is g2 of f3. I am taking one more division here, namely this 1/3 is here, 1/3. This will be 1/4. Between 1/4 to 1/3 is f3. And keep this one as x. So keep going, keep doing that. Next time you delete this one, put a line on the left of this, 1/5, and so on. So keep going, define this way. So this is g1, g2, g3, and so on. Okay. Each gn plus 1 is well defined and is homotopy of the identity map to the last gn plus 1. Gn plus 1 is, look at this definition here, gn. Little gn of this already composite is gn minus g last one fn plus 1. So this become gn of into composition fn plus 1. So gn plus 1. So starting with x here, the last thing is when you t equal to 1, this is gn plus 1. Okay, that is a clear. All right. So all gn is a homotopy of the identity map gn plus 1. Each gn plus 1 is a strong definite tract of un plus 1 or 2. Moreover, restricted to un cross I, it is gn. Therefore, inductively, you can define, a map g from u cross I to u, but given by g of xt to gn of xt whenever x is inside un. By chance you would have shown un plus 1, doesn't matter. The definition will be the same because gn plus 1 of xt, if x is inside un, is also gn of xt. Okay. Now, if V is an open subset of U, then G inverse of V equal to intersection with xn is equal to G inverse of V intersection with UN, because the domain of this inside XN, it is just UN. The G inverse of, once it is UN, G is nothing but GN, GN inverse of V intersection XN. And hence, for each UN, this intersection is, okay, it's open in UN. This means G inverse of V is open in U. Okay, so I am just showing that G is continuous as a map from U into U cross I into U naught, U cross I into U, but U cross I into finally U naught. Therefore, G is continuous. Okay, therefore, G is a strong deformational tract of U into U naught. Okay, so here you have to work much harder to get a inductive homotopy. Okay, now we come to standard lemma in again inside DN. Okay, so we have to work, you know, familiar with Euclidean space. You can do whatever you like, and then you want to extend them to simple shape complexes. This is the game we are playing. So growing whiskers, this lemma, you can call it as growing whiskers. You take a subset of SN minus 1 boundary and choose any epsilon between 0 and 1. Set up n epsilon equal to all those x inside Dn which are at a distance from the boundary less than 1 minus epsilon. Norm of x is bigger than epsilon. But the modulus, divided modulus, the unit vector must be inside A. Okay, so it just means that take a point inside A and then draw a small line segment of length less than 1 minus epsilon inside the disk. So that is the whiskers. So it's growing whiskers there. So n epsilon is such a thing. Clearly, this is an open subset of Dn, provided A is open in Sn minus 1. Okay, because I have taken closed intervals on one side and a half closed interval, open in the interior, inside. Inside part is open, norm x bigger than Sn. Okay, in any case, if you intersect it to Sn minus 1, it's precisely A, that this second condition gives you that. This is an open subset of Dn if and only if A is an open subset of Sn minus 1, because intersection is this one. The third thing is, you can push the whole thing back to A, namely xt going to 1 minus t times x, tx divided by norm x. This is a point of A. Okay, this is a strong deformative tract of n epsilon onto A. Okay. If epsilon can be chosen as small, as large as you please, very close to 1, depending upon your requirement, this is going to give you arbitrary small open neighborhoods of this A inside Dn, which is a strong deformative tract of epsilon. So this is the germ of the idea, starting point, which is happening in the Euclidean space. From this, we want to capture it to and take it to all the simplicial complexes. Okay, so this is a picture. Dn is the disk. A is some subset. I have shown it as an arc here. This may be open arc or a closed arc. You don't know. If it's closed arc, these endpoints will be there. If it's an open arc, even these endpoints will not be there. And this n epsilon A will be an open subset. Okay, so this remark is very important. Starting with an open subset of Dn such that A bar is inside U. Now A bar is inside U allows you, A bar becomes compact. We can choose 0 less than epsilon less than 1 such that this n epsilon A is contained inside U. So that is because this becomes compact. Okay. So I think this much topology you know. Now we have the big theorem. Let L be any subcomplex of a simplicial complex. Let U be an open subset of mod K which contains mod L. Then there exists an open subset V of mod K contained inside U and containing mod L, such that this L is a strong deformation tract of V. Okay. In particular, we know that this will imply that the inclusion map mod L to V is a cofibration. In particular, it gives you many other results. First, let us work out how you got this one. Okay. We shall construct this V, the open set, as well as the strong deformative tract inductively. We start with V naught equal to L. In the lemma, in the general lemma, or a theorem, whatever it is, this one, yeah, this theorem. This U was an open subset of X. We didn't have to construct this one. Okay. Here we are constructing that. The subset we are constructing. Okay, put V naught equal to L. Assume that we have constructed an open set Vn of Kn such that Vn minus 1 is contained inside Vn, contained inside U. This U is given. There we applied the whole thing to U intersection Un and so on. Now we have to construct some Vn inside that and then apply it to Vn's itself. That is our idea. Okay, suppose we have constructed an open set Vn of Kn such that the old thing is contained inside the new one. The open subsets are getting extended here. Okay, this is not actually open subset. This V naught equal to L is not an open set. So I'm not claiming that. This is just like A getting extended to an epsilon. You can just think of that way. Okay, Vn minus 1 contained inside Vn, but Vn will be contained inside U. Vn is retracting, Vn minus 1 is a strong definite retraction of Vn. There's a strong definite retraction Vn to Vn minus 1. So this is the inductive step we want to do. Okay, we have not yet done it. So now index all the n plus 1 simplexes f of k such that f is not in L, because L part we don't want to trouble, but bf intersects L. They are nearer, they are not far away. Bf does not intersect L, you ignore them. They don't have to worry. If bf, the boundary, intersects L, put them there. Okay, provided they are already not there. That means they are not inside L. For each such Fn, for each of F, which is a n plus 1 simplex, okay, from the previous lemma, we get an open set Vf inside F such that Bf intersection L is contained inside Vf, contained inside U, and a strong differentiated tract Rf from Vf to the boundary Bf intersection L. Okay. So how did you get this one? This is by growing Whiskers. On each of these, okay, this is just growing Whiskers lemma. Okay. So put now Vn plus 1 equal to Vn union all these n plus 1 Whiskers, Vf. Okay, F is inside n plus 1. The new n plus 1 simplexes which are not already inside L. Okay, now Rn plus 1 will be defined by patching up these Rfs. So each Rf, Rn plus 1, is equal to Rf on Vf. So this will give you a retraction of Vn plus 1 to Vn. Strong different retraction. Okay. Now put V equal to union of Vn. This V is open in mod K. None of the Vn's are open. Okay. They are open inside Kn. That is the point here. Okay. So now I have to just appeal to this big theorem that we proved to say that once you have retractions like this, you can patch them up. So V is open inside K, model is contained inside V, contained inside U, because each Vn is contained inside U. You can now appeal to this theorem to obtain a strong different retraction from R, R from V to mod L. Okay. The conclusion is every polyhedron is locally contractible. So this is a stronger conclusion we have come up now. Namely, which you couldn't do earlier. We could do only semi-locally contractibility. Now it's every polyhedron is locally contractible. How do you do that? So take any point X, make it into a vertex by choosing an appropriate subdivision. Once it's a vertex, singleton V will become a subcomplex. Okay. So one, now you can apply for the subcomplex, you have done this one. Okay. So there is a strong deformation. So there is a neighborhood V. V strongly deformed retracts to X. That means V is contractible. Okay. This time we are not using the strong deformation inside U at all, but inside V cross I to V itself you can. Okay. This is just a corollary to this strong result, namely every simplex, every subcomplex of a simplicial complex has this property, namely it is locally NDR pair. There is a neighborhood which retracts strongly to model. Okay. So let us stop here.